Oh, a little led off for Johnny Bairstow. For the tea interval. Bold on his way back to the pavilion. Umpires check the delivery. Peter Siddle is tight. And he was on this occasion, he was over the line. So a life for Johnny Bairstow. He's out there with Ian Bell, who's on 62 from 131 deliveries. Bairstow 28 from 70. 183 for 4. Might not sound brilliant, but when you think that England were 28 for 3, it's a bit of a recovery. Ryan Harris is the man who's done most of the damage. 3 for 28 from 13 overs. Pattinson, none for 52. Watson picked up the first wicket, 1 for 22, that of the England captain, Alistair Cook. Ryan Harris has problems with his injuries over the years, kept him out of a lot of cricket. Broke down in the last time England were over than Australia as well. Remember rightly. England are on a bat this session out now. It's interesting, watching the pitch, Nasser. Watching it today, I've seen the odd ball seaming around a bit. I've seen a couple turn. Just wonder if it's quite the belter everyone thought it was. So as time will tell.
I thought the new ball nibbled a little bit. I think it looks a pretty good surface. Sun out. It looks like a new ball pitch to me. You can get to overcome that new ball. Plenty of runs to be had out there. You wouldn't worry about batting on that, would you?
Depends who's bowling. The West Indies used to worry about them us playing on a feather bed. But, no, I think your point's right. You wouldn't worry too much about batting on it. As a bowler, you just think, if I get it right, there's a chance. But I agree with you. I think we're talking the first 20 overs, aren't we? To make the most, make the inroads then. Anyway, do some batting. Pattinson, Siddle. All of them are bowl, I think. They might stay with McGar, but he looked like he was struggling a little bit before with a leg or thigh injury. We'll keep an eye on that. Miss out very often in that area, Ian Bell. It's the young man. Burst on the scene up at Trent Bridge. Away, just a single.
Been impressive, Harris, hasn't he? Maybe he's the sort of cricketer, because of his physical problems over the years, that he just didn't fancy playing in back-to-back tests. Maybe he's the sort of you always just have to look after. There's a few days off after this test match, so he can then rest up for Old Trafford. So I think the Aussies have picked well with their bowlers.
Yeah, I have to say, I was listening to the guys talking earlier, and you might well have been in on the conversation, but about the workload of the bowlers, etc. Well, there's 9 days off after this test. So, 9 days off here, then you have 3 days again between the Manchester and Durham game, and then you've got a week after that. There was the first wicket, Joe Root. He thought he hit it, but he did, but I think it was a pad first. It was a good decision, well worked out. And then 4 balls later, Kevin Peterson just feeling for that. Just a little bit of shape. And then Jonathan Trott, I'm quite sure, I think he was just trying to work out his hip. It almost looks like a leading edge. But it certainly spooned it up in the air, and it stayed up there for a long time. 2 from the over, 185 for 4. It's only 13 matches, 50 wickets. Average is good, 20, very good in modern day game. 2 5-wicket hauls. March 2010 was his first game. So you'd have expected probably a few more matches under his belt, but he's had problems with injuries.
In fact, these two, as a captain, Michael Clark's got his fingers crossed, really, at slip. Two big, strong lads, but they do snap when they bowl a lot.
Ryan Harris has actually played only a third of the games that were available for him as an Australian player in that period of time, so that tells you there are a few problems. Shane Watson, well, I watched him warm up at Trent Bridge after he'd been in the field today, and he tried to bowl the delivery. Honestly, I don't think it got the other end. He really does stiffen up. See, when he gets going, mid-80s, slowest ball is probably that last one, the loosener. Goes short, wide, goes after it, went after it hard, picks up four, it's in the air, but quite safe.
Well, that's the thing with Johnny Bairstow. Yes, he might have this technical failing of playing across straight balls and missing them, but you bowl him a bad ball, he will put it away. I mean, he didn't mean this to go down to third man, but he does score runs quickly, and when you're coming in at number six, that's a very valuable asset to have.
It was there, wasn't it? It was short and wide, so go at it. Go at it hard. Exactly what he did. Pattinson doing the fielding at mid-on. Trying to encourage bowlers. So David Frost doesn't miss many games of cricket at Lord's. Loves coming along. No. So just that one boundary from the over, 189 for four. Partnership 62 then between these two. Those two played a bit of cricket, caused a bit of chaos for the England team. Ponty on the left, Gilchrist on the right. Don't play golf with Ricky Ponting, Ness, especially the way you're playing at the moment.
I don't play golf full stop at the moment, the way I'm playing.
Was it the Rabbit Warren or somewhere we used to play? He's a serious golfer, Ponting. Very, very good player. He masquerades off, I think, scratch. A bit like that Simon Dool. Should probably be about plus two, plus three. And just sat in front of Adam Gilchrist there. Former Prime Minister of Australia, John Howard. There on the right, just below Adam Gilchrist. He is mad keen on the game of cricket. They've had a history of that with their Prime Minister. Bob Hawke was the same. I'm sure Julia Gillard was. Might be doing her an injustice, but I think certainly John Howard, Natigal.
Happy about something behind the bowler's arm, whether it's been the members just standing there.
Shot, punch down the ground, it'll go all the way.
Well, that's the risk reward. You can see what they're trying to do with Bairstow, full and straight, and that was excellent from Bairstow. He got his bat coming down online, didn't close the bat face, didn't play across it.
It was interesting when Kevin Peterson of Trent Bridge said exactly the same thing on this kind of pitches. You cannot afford to start working the ball in there. You've got to show the full face. Maybe KP's had a little quiet word with Johnny Bairstow and just pointed that out. That's much better.
Funny, isn't that? No ball. I always think of the next batsman in. I mean, Matt Prior must have been up out of his seat, halfway down, into the members, into the long room, and then thinking, well, why hasn't Johnny Bairstow come off the field?
I bet he got down to the long room.
Yeah, and you just sort of stood there in the long room, with the members all round you, and Bairstow's still in the middle, and he has to go all the way back up.
I don't think he'll mind going back up. There he is. Fire from that over, 194 for four. Is it 4:30 coming up in the afternoon? Glorious day here at Lord's. People outside tell me it's very hot. Not getting any breeze in the arena.
Yeah, we're copping a bit of flack from our Aussie viewers saying 28 degrees, very hot. Are you sure?
Yeah, well, they've been over there for years, haven't they? They're used to it. Been baked for years. It is, though, they're quite right. It's only about 28, 30s, nothing, 40, 42, 44 when it gets really hot over there. But they'll be enjoying it, very pleasant. Saw my mate Merv Hughes earlier on. He's busy doing some rehydrating with this heat. Big mate of yours, Merv?
Yeah, I played with him a little bit at Essex. came down. He was on an SO scholarship, so I played with quite a few Aussies there. Alan Border at Essex, Mark Waugh. Steve Waugh was on an SO scholarship early on in his career, came across.
Some character, isn't he, Merv?
Absolutely. Good bowler as well, not just the character. He used to steam him.
Well, on Saturday, show, Saturday story, Merv will be in there, featuring.
What day is that on?
The day after Friday now. And I think it comes before Sunday, last time I looked. Is that funny then? Nicely placed, nicely timed. Two. Oh, I just wonder if anyone else at home picked that up then. A little NASA funny. Blimey, a state of shock. I did smile.
Done a couple now this year. Can't remember the last one, to be honest. Or the next.
Well, I'm sure they'll all be sat at home waiting with bated breath. Missed out on that last ball. Four from the over, 198 for four. Specsavers blimp. Yeah. It's almost table tennis shot, wasn't it? Like top hand, top spin. So it brings the 200 up there for England at two.
Yeah, it just hurried him a bit. Harris seems to do that occasionally. Everyone just has him as a little bit medium pace to get forward to. He did that to Trott on a couple of occasions. Quick arm, big shoulders. No noticeable change in action for that short ball. Yes.
Two more here. Well directed. It's a good line if you're going to bowl a bouncer over the off stump, so it's not so easy for the batsman who wants to play the shot to get inside the line, and you don't have quite the same control. Played it pretty well. Oh, that's good running. Slight misfield, Shane Watson. Alert to it. Picked up a single. Five from the over, 203 for four. Overs gone then today. And 203 for four. Pattinson coming back into the attack. 13 overs, two mains, none for 52 so far. Oh, hang on. Oh, his extras here.
Gotta love a good buzzer. How many buzzers are that? Two buzzers? Clark not amused.
Brad Haddon gets the throw away. Not in any general direction. Now, you're going to have to explain to everyone at home, Ness.
It's just what you shout in club cricket, isn't it? Standing there and someone hurls it, everyone shouts out, buzzers, run up, one for the arm, man in. I think it's a posh thing. Eaton and Harrow used to shout buzzers at each other.
That's through the offside. It's going to go all the way. That, no one's catching that down the slope. More to the total.
Sweet cover drive, opens the face. Classic Bell.
Very much so. The way he watches that onto the bat. Total control, knows where he's going, knows where the fielders are. Well, it's going down for me. Now, the Australians haven't got a great record with the Ferrell system. 2 out of 9 so far this series.
Good delivery, but just at full pace, it looked like it did too much. Reverse swing, swinging towards the shiny side.
Yeah, they got way down. Way down, Nashira. Bit of reverse swing there.
Yeah, that will keep England interested. Seeing the ball reverse after 58, so they'll be using that come second time round, but Pattinson's got it in his hands now. Yeah, late movement with a reverse swing. Bell staying pretty much leg side of it with his feet. puts him just in line with leg stump. Doesn't have far to travel, but just that extra distance gets it past the leg stump.
Shot. No ball and four more.
Yeah, don't worry about the no ball. Arguably Bell's best shot of the day. Just back of a length, shows what a good pitch this is. Clark can't believe the shot. There's the no ball. That is sweet. Top of the bounce, save your legs, Ian Bell. He doesn't bother moving. Right out the middle. Great hot spot, that. Right in the middle of the bat. Ian Bell watching the ball.
All from this over. There's going to be more runs. No one's catching that one either. So 16 from the over, it's 219 for four. Partnership now moves on to 92. Dan and Bairstow, 16 runs off that last over. That was the final boundary, punched through the offside. Michael Clark won't be too happy with that. But two guys who are happy with it, Andrew Strauss and David Gow.
Thanks, Ian. Yeah, problems for James Pattinson. Talented player, youngster, and finding that touring England is not easy. But this, I'm sure, is what counts as a learning experience, for sure. Number 68 from his 14, so Michael Clark had to consider his options. Best on 46. Been batting for 111 minutes. One big stroke of luck, of course. Bowled off a no ball. Yeah. Good shot. Just the one, though.
Swatted away there by Johnny Bairstow. It's a funny one, isn't it, when you're bowled off a no ball like that. I think mentally, you start thinking to yourself, listen, the gods have got something in store for me today. It's like you often see a batsman that's dropped a slip or something, they go on and make the most of it. It's going to be the challenge for Bairstow now. Can he make the most of that really good bit of fortune he had there? Had a overthrow a couple of overs ago, David, and commentators were talking about it being a buzzer. Any idea where the origin of that comes from?
Atherton, Cambridge University. Apparently it was a term they used at Fenner's for overthrows. Buzzers. What's this leading to?
I was just wondering. They were intimating that you might be the man that would know the answer to that.
Only because I've known Atherton for a while now. And these sort of faux Mancunian tones of his. You know. He does use words that can only have come from somewhere like Fenner's. Very good people, I have to say. He's very, very good with his words. Yeah, but I hadn't heard the term buzzers before he first mentioned it. I'm not sure about the MCC dress code today. Normally very strict. Good bouncer. It's one from the over. 220 for four. Yeah, normally you see the Panama hats that are the majority of the headwear you can see there. The old knotted handkerchief probably makes sense. Just go under the umbrella. Just ask them very nicely, can I join you under the umbrella? All sorts of vantage points, of course, around this ground, but it's, for us in the UK, it's what's known as a very, very hot day, somewhere around 30 degrees. So, Paddington's one over spell, maybe not surprisingly over, it went for 16 runs, change of pace completely with Ashton Agar. He's approaching the 50, but just doing it in singles at the moment, Johnny Bairstow. 48 now.
Michael Clark ringing the changes again. At Lords, you get these periods where the wicket looks very flat. Looks like there's nothing in it for any bowling, really. I suppose that's where you've got to change things around. There's no reverse swing. There's been no hint of reverse swing, really. Spinner's got a job to do here. Dry up the scoring rate a little bit.
You're not going to expect much, are you, on a Lord's pitch, first day blazing sunshine for the spinner off the pitch. Any footmarks would be relevant, maybe very slightly if there were a left-hander around, but off the pitch, off the middle of the pitch, shouldn't be much to help anyone, to be honest, at this stage. Not sure he's entirely fit, actually, either, Ashton Agar. Signs that he might just have done something to himself early in the day. We'll maybe find out about that. But if nothing much is happening, that's all you want, isn't it, as a captain? You want to control where you can put the field, control the scoring rate, just tighten things up a bit if at all possible. Good shot. Very delicate, very clever. Beautifully timed.
Yeah, how many times have we said over the last two games, Ian Bell using the pace of the ball, getting that fine of the backward point fielder. We're really waiting for the ball and guiding it rather than hitting it. Real strength of Bell's game. Big high backlift there. Nice timing. It's one of those times as a captain where you feel like you need to make something happen, I suppose. End of the over there, 225 for four. Doesn't feel like there's anything really happening, so you feel under pressure to try and make something happen, but often that's the worst thing you can do. You end up chasing your tail a bit, ups the scoring rate, and you lose control of the game completely.
Yeah, I agree with that. There's nothing much you can do, then don't try and overcook it. Obviously, there are other times where there are options available. The first thing, when you've had an over go for 16, is just to try and get a maiden ball. And if you, you know, as a captain, as a bowler, you know, you just saw Michael Clark there talking to Peter Siddle. you'll basically say, what's happening? If the answer's nothing, well, okay, let's just try and stick to the basics for now. Just, I mean, you're a great fan of trying to build pressure, quite rightly at times, by stopping the scoring rate. Because the worst thing you do is over-egg it, as you say, and then see 4, 5, 6 and over going.
It's always my theory that if you could just build up dots against most modern-day batsmen, used to one-day cricket, they used to 2020 cricket, they want to play their shots, they want to hit boundaries. And it's amazing how often that worked for us. Just 2 or 3 maidens in a row often brought a wicket for us. This sort of wicket, very hard to string together those maidens, though.
They got it from Shane Watson at Trembridge, didn't they? Second innings especially, a whole, what was it, 75% of maidens he bought. Just by putting it there or thereabouts, that brisk medium pace, no more than that. And that does give you something to work with. If nothing else much is happening, it does give you something to work with. At least you feel as a captain it's not getting away from you. I remember, obviously it has to be a long time ago now if I go back to my career, but 89, Headingley, somehow he managed to stick Australia in and somehow they managed to get a whole stack of runs. But at some stage there, I was literally saying to bowlers, right, let's just, you know, forget everything else, just try and bowl a maiden. Because by trying too many things, trying to bowl something that's going to move away, move in, and getting it slightly wrong on what was a very good pitch for once there, we were just leaking runs, 4, 5 and over. Say, so, okay, fine, let's just go back to the simple things. Gonna push for the second. Quite rightly not opting to try it. Goes to 49.
These Lord's wickets, I often found it quite, well, I didn't find it hard to bowl maidens, but bowlers often found it with a slope that batsmen could easily score both sides of the wickets. You couldn't protect both sides. Sometimes there's a case, I know it's a very negative ploy, but maybe just go 3 or 4 overs, let's hang it. Have 7-2 field. Just say to the batsman, if you want to play the shot, fine, but we've got 7 fielders that side. Up to you.
Well, in days gone by, it was a very Australian thing, especially in Australia, when the Kookaburra ball had gone soft, nothing much has happened, to bowl just wide of off stump. At that sort of length where if you wanted to go at it, you were taking a risk. And again, same principle would be that we have all those fielders on that side. A couple of slips in, so if you wanted to nick it, you could. And they might pick you. But it was just a pure contest of patience. Didn't have to last all day. One of those things they did, given that nothing else was happening.
Well, the other thing, Ian Bell on 83 here, he's used to hitting the ball. That's what he wants to do. He wants to hit the ball. He wants to score. Sometimes if you just say, oh, I'm going to hang it outside your off stump, are you willing to leave it? If you're on naught, you'd leave it, but you're on 83. Do you fancy it? Ian Bell, probably a tricky customer to do it to because he'll try and run you down to third man. But even then, maybe you're bringing the slips into play as a result of that.
I think we can guess there's going to be a slight delay here. Something to do with the helmet. It might just be the innards, which on a day like this will get hot and sweaty. Ian Bell just waiting for the attentions of the 12th man. New lining, new helmet lining. They'll want to go back and either be put in a warm place to dry or left in the sun. This is how the wickets have gone down today. Nice to put first to go, LBW. Good decision from Murray Erasmus. Joe Root, tricky one this. Bat and pad very close together and contact almost simultaneous. Given out, not overturned. four balls later. Good delivery from Ryan Harris. And Peterson's edge was found there. 99 runs later. Jonathan Trott didn't mean to get an error, I'm sure, like that, but carried all the way to Usman Khawaja at deep square leg. So those are the four wickets that have gone down. It's 226 for four now. Agar over the wicket now. That's 50. Johnny Bairstow has 50 again at Lord's. He made a couple last year against South Africa. And he's made one now against Australia. Did need that slice of luck on 21. But enjoying the moment now.
Yeah, well played, Johnny Bairstow. That little bit of luck, bowled off a no ball, but otherwise he's played well. Scored all around the ground. 50 of 96 balls. He's been pretty fluent. Well played.
Two milestones in one. 50 for Bairstow, 100 partnership up as well, off 173 balls. Now becomes the highest partnership of the day. Easy enough just to kick those away. It's outside leg stump.
So this is the other method you can try and employ. Hit 100 partnership between Bairstow and Bell. 174 balls. Both been very fluent today.
Yep. But like all these ploys, you have to get the length right. It's twice now in this over that he's been a little bit short. Once he's that short, basically both times, Bairstow has just got back on the back foot, plenty of time to look at it, nudged it onside for one. So you've got to keep it fuller than that. Bell and Bairstow each have done that now.
Down!
In a sense, as a slower Tommy, don't mind the batsman playing those shots. If you're just slightly wrong with the length and there's a little bit of grip out of the rough, maybe, that's when you might get the leading edge. So to actually get the man playing at four balls just outside leg stump, you don't mind that so much as a slow left arm.
Yeah, again, Clark's just going, listen, I'm going to get my bowler to chuck it in the rough there. Do you want to play a shot? If you want to, you're taking a risk. Otherwise, I'm quite happy dotting you up. So, kind of turning into a bit of a war of attrition here. That only works, that tactic only works if you can build up the pressure. Just having a look at Bairstow's 50 here. Some really good shots. He's always been a good boundary hitter. And there's that outrageous bit of fortune. Just on the line from Peter Siddle. And small margins this game. Made the spinner well, cut it away. He looks determined to make the most of his fortune here, Johnny Bairstow.
Well, your point was right just now when you say if you've had a stroke of luck like that, then you really should say, OK, this has to be my day. You really should actually, if you use the psychology correctly, encourage you to say, right, still got to concentrate, still got to bat well. But you've got a feeling that things are going your way, so make the most of it. Last year, he got out for 95 against South Africa and on a day when we thought he might just get there, make the 100. And you don't want to get ahead of yourself, there's only 51 at the moment, but that sort of thought must come into his mind later.
The other thing was almost the method of his non-dismissal, if that makes sense. The fact that he's bowled again, he knows as well as anyone, people have been talking about his fallibility against that full straight one. Now he gets a second chance and he'll be aware, right, okay, wasn't right, made a mistake there, let's make sure I don't repeat that mistake.
Well, that was the thing, at the start of the innings, he made a real effort to get the bat coming down, not like that, but much straighter. Playing back through the ball. And quite logically, if you've got that sort of thing in your mind, if you've got that sort of fault, which he's obviously aware about, because you can see from the way he worked really hard at the start of the season, he was trying ever so hard to cope with that. Just have to keep it going. It's got to become, over a period of time, it's got to become absolutely ingrained, hasn't it? Completely second nature. You don't want to have to think about it, you just want it to happen naturally.
Yeah, I mean, it is a technical fault of his. We all have technical faults. He's not alone in that regard. You've just got to be aware of it. So if it is full and straight, maybe don't play big shots at it.
Almost the danger area. A little bit too leg stump that time.
Always felt, I don't know if you felt like this, but never wanted to get out the same way twice. You almost, if you get out LBW first things, you're very conscious about making sure you don't do it second things. But for as much a reason as any is you don't want people saying, well, he's got this massive technical fallibility. Bairstow's probably got out that same way too often. He'll be very aware of that.
You obviously didn't watch much of my career then, because I did make the same mistake many a time. I suppose given the play often enough, you will do. but I do take the point. I understand the point. Innings by innings. And there will be times in your career where you get a tag for something. There was one stage where I remember being told I kept being caught at mid-on. Which made a nice change from second slip, you know. And suddenly, you know, you haven't thought about it until someone tells you it's an issue. Then you start to think about it. Well, there's one of those maidens we were talking about, 229 for Forster. Well, this always looked like a day for batting, and those that have missed out will be bitterly disappointed, I'm sure. Cook, Root and Peterson. Trott will be disappointed too, because 58 for him is a job only a half done, if that. Variety in these bowling figures as well. Harris, playing his first test of the series, has been excellent. 3 for 41 in his various bursts that have added up to 17 overs. Round the wicket again.
Having a look at these rough patches outside the right-hander's leg stump here, which is why Agar went over the wicket for a while. It's definitely quite a lot there for day one of a test match. Oh. But it's interesting that he's gone back round the wicket now. So he's obviously felt that not doing enough out of those rough patches to justify the lack of wicket-taking threat from over the wicket. He can't get a bowl, he can't get an LBW. He's come back round, trying to bowl probably stump to stump here, I would have thought. How do you keep getting caught mid-on?
Slow pitches. Mistiming. I was trying to work on the off stump, you know, not getting caught outside the off stump bit, you know. Trying to play the other way. Trust me, over a period of time, people can give you any number of tags, can't they? I mean, there were times, okay, there was the, you know, the so-called waft outside off stump, you know, helping it off Roberts, Holding, Garner, Croft, Marshall, you know, towards second or third slip. Mid-on, deep square leg, of course, Gooch will remember that one. Happened once, that was enough for him. Unfortunate time, that's a rarity. No ball from the spinner.
Are you conscious of that reputation? Did that change the way you played at all? Or are you quite happy to live up to the reputation?
Questions. Another easy one. I wasn't happy to live up to the reputation, is the honest answer. But I was happy to play to my strengths. So in other words, the area that people said, that's a problem, round about off stump, was also rather a good area for scoring runs. I always just say at the end of it, OK, if the figures, they might have been better with a bit more discipline, but they weren't bad.
Go around!
232 for four. Actually, when we look at players nowadays, I mean, there's some good figures out there, good averages. As we've seen, you know, Cook is soaring away with the number 100 scored. Bell's up there now with 18. You're very easy to remember or to look at players minute by minute and find little faults here and there. But actually, try and remember, you need to look over a long period of time and, if possible, at the good side too. There's a lot of talent out there.
Well, the other thing is, you can't be scared of playing shots, can you? I mean, you can worry about how you get out, but ultimately you've got to go out there and find a way of scoring runs. And you can see people that are playing with fear don't look like they're going to score anything.
It's up in the air, but it hasn't got the legs on it to carry. He's played a number of those shots today. Most have been under control. That was a top edge, but luckily didn't carry.
Just like you're surprised with the pace a little bit there. Him high on the bat.
Well, part of the issue is where he actually played it from. Just look from side on. Look where he is. He's out of his crease. He's coming forward. Obviously not thinking about short ball at all.
It's the front foot there from Bairstow and out of the crease, so he's playing that probably a yard and a half earlier than he needs to. It's like a bit more difficult for yourself, doesn't it?
Well, he's obviously thinking that the way Siddle was bowling was going to be full length and straight, you know, simple as that. He's got to a confident place, Johnny Bairstow. If you're thinking about all the options, then you'd be still batting from the crease. And actually, it's just another reminder, isn't it? Again, good to be thinking positively about where you're going to score your runs. But this guy's no mug, Peter Siddle. And he's got enough pace, he's not express, but he's got enough pace even on a pitch like this, just to push you back a bit. So if you're... It's something to ponder, isn't it, for Johnny Bairstow? You know, he's got away with it. It was a top edge. It didn't carry. Take the one and think about it.
It's good bowling from Siddle, really, because... If you know there's a chance of a bouncer coming your way, you probably won't do what Bairstow does there. You'll be staying further back in your crease. So it's always a good point for a fast bowler, just the odd bumper now and again, just to keep the batsman honest. Even if it's not that quick a wicket, batsman will be thinking of it. You know, none of us really like facing bouncers. So it just kind of keeps it there in the back of your mind.
Good cricket, good running, good fielding. Bats from both safely home. No problems there. That's good bowling, didn't quite time it there. Change of pace again. 234 for four. Wonderful views. We've seen them a few times today, but glorious views across a sun-baked London from the Specsavers blimp. 2:34 it is. Pondering going on out in the middle between captain and bowler. It's a bit of pondering now for the next half hour or so from Shane Warne and David Lott.
Thanks, David. And England increasing the run rate. It's healthy. 3.55 runs and over. Partnership of 107 between Bell and Bairstow. Better pitch, Shane, to play spin on than at Trent Bridge. It was one of those pitches that got to be really careful against the spinner, ball not coming onto the bat, keeping low. Oh! How's he missed that? It's that full ball again.
Afternoon, Bumble. Good afternoon, everyone. This looked full, too. Just late on it, Ian Bell. It's played beautifully. It's just missed the stumps, too. This partnership, excellent one. Bairstow was clean bowled by Siddle off a no ball. Since then, these two have played well.
Oh, we'll try and miss that fielder there. Short and wide delivery. So many at Lords were defeated by the full ball. I mean, it's almost a full toss. Trent Bridge first test match, a real interesting pitch. Couldn't take any liberties with the pitch. Got to be real careful as a batsman.
And it was slow too. The batsman could play off the back foot, had plenty of time. You know, obviously, as you say, the odd one stayed down a little bit, but it looks pretty good. Swing a bit with a new ball and flatten out with the older ball.
And it looked at Trent Bridge, it should have been doing all sorts for the spinner, but it was that slow. So much rough outside off stump, left hand and right hand, with Australia having the left armour coming charging in. Mitchell Stark. .234 for 4. How's he going, this left arm spinner?
Yeah, I was just thinking about it's watching him bowl the last sort of few hours about how he's been bowling, and I think it's hard to judge on day one when there's not much off the surface, but he looked pretty good through the air. He bowls a lot of overspin on the ball. There's not too much side spin. He looks pretty organized. You know, there's nothing a lot there, but I think as time goes on this pitch, he might be able to get a bit more spin.
Well, we saw him in that first test match, and he's tall. What are his assets? He's got long fingers, he's tall, he's wiry, he's got a good action. Yeah, he's 19, he's going to bowl some bad balls every now and again. The captain's got to just protect him in that area. But the way that he batted... I said on commentary, I said, England will never mention this lad. And then came straight in and said, Australia don't know him either. If they put in this kid in at number 11, they don't know him.
He played phenomenally with the bat. In his own mind, he'd be there to get wickets. And no one would have seen him. No one would have expected it. The way he played, too, was outstanding. He's a good young prospect. He's in the team to take wickets. These are the times where your spinner just needs to jag one. In the first innings, just break a partnership at a crucial time. Quickie's come back on.
Did you see his interview? It was fantastic. He got his baggy green and he stood there with this huge smile on his face. When did you get to know you? About 2 days ago, Buff told me I was playing. He said I had to ring my mum and dad, and there he is. And then he had a picture on the outfield with his mum. His dad was there, his brothers, his mates, all stood on the outfield, him in the middle with his baggy green. He spoke so well, terrifically well. I did a mischief piece. He didn't step up to the plate, put his hand up to be counted, stand up. Never went to the party. Didn't think about getting in the right areas. He didn't execute his skills. Taking the positives. He just had a chat.
I remember him saying it was the best day of his life. Good on him. Australia need him to take some wickets. This partnership.
Wide of the crease again. Got to go.
Oh!
Oh my goodness me. You think it's going to go to the bowler's end.
This partnership's worth a lot, but it nearly ended. A little bit of lazy running here. It was good fielding by Chris Rogers. He threw to the keeper's end. I reckon if this hits, he was gone. He was out. But that's only just missed too. Wasn't expecting the ball to come to his end.
No mistakes at this time, England. I think that, you know, what we're seeing today with this surface is it's end of day's play. Yeah, four downs, okay. Precarious at 127 for four. Decent feel from Michael Clark. When you look at this, there's a slip and a very fine gully and a fielder just short mid-wicket on the leg side for that chip into the leg side. He's got the hook covered at deep backward square and at fine leg. It'll change slightly for Bairstow. I don't think the fielder will be at deep backward square. I think Australia always like to keep that short mid-wicket in. Just that little chip into the leg side. Two 36 for four. Finn not playing. Bresnan slots into this lineup and he's a handy batsman. It pushes Swan down to 10, so England also would be saying that there's a decent batting lineup there. Pryor in next, plays his way. Be very attacking. There's that bad ball that you're going to get from a 19-year-old and you sit on him as a batsman, a class player like Bell, who moves into the 90s, 91 Bell.
Good shot. Just the width here, the player that's in, just a little bit wide. He's very strong in that area, Ian Bell. Plenty of time, knows the bounce now, trusts the bounce. So it's just a matter of hitting it in the right gap, and when it gets down that slope, runs away. In the 90s, Ian Bell.
Oh! That's nice.
Good, Ash.
Two or three deliveries ago, the ball that was cut for four, it pitches and disturbs the surface. Look there.
One bad shot.
Bit of dust.
Bad shot.
open face. He's manoeuvred this well. Johnny Bairstow into the offside. It's just a couple.
Yeah, we looked at that couple of balls ago. We show you that replay of the ball just disturbing the surface. It was quite wide of the off stump, but when we were looking at the wicket this morning, it was quite dry. A little bit of grass on there. It looked pretty flat. Interesting just to keep an eye on that just through the test match to see if it happens any more or gets worse. Still looks a pretty good strip to me.
There again, this will be four. There's enough on this to travel quickly down the hill. End of the 69th over, England, 247 for four. Bairstow on to 60. Change of bowling, James Pattinson into the attack. Last over went for 16, so 14 overs, none for 68. Pavilion end.
It hasn't been at his best today, James Pattinson. Normally pretty good. He bowls with some pace and some fire, and that's what they Australia need right now. England's partnership of 120 between this pair, getting themselves into a strong position. Australia need a wicket. They need a spell from Pattinson now, a bit of aggression, just to try and rough up ball, try and get something happening. You just sense since that no-ball incident when Australia thought they had Bairstow bowl and that would have been 175 for five. Then it's just gone a bit flat. Ball's gone soft, the wicket's flat, the sun's shining. This is the time where you need these guys to stand up, your main men, the Siddles, the Pattinsons. You need one of them to grab the game by the scruff of the neck and say, come with me, lads. A bit of energy, a bit of aggression. They need something from him.
Well, big word, energy. Commitment in the field, it could come from the wicket keeper, bit of magic from a fielder, maybe a run out or a stunning catch, but a response from your bowlers. And you're dead right, your coaching and your captains want all four stroke five bowlers to be on top of the game all the time. It doesn't happen. We saw that in the last test match. Anderson irresistible, other bowlers striving to get any sort of rhythm. Ian Bell is into the 90s as England move on to 250 for four. He's looking for a third consecutive Ashes century. Scored a century at Sydney, scored a century at Trent Bridge. He's on 93 here. It's been done before, of course. Four times, twice by Jack Hobbs, Wally Hammond once, Chris Broad once.
It'd be a good time to do it here at Lord's too when you're 28 for 3 and guide your team into a position of strength. The other thing, just go back to the bowler's bumble, is that when you've just got to find a way. It only takes one person with the bowlers to actually get into it. You have to grab that game by the scruff of the neck. And it's not just bowling with a bit of line of length and waiting for something to happen. You nearly force something to happen through your presence and your energy about what it is. Now, it might be we're going to bowl full and wide for a while. We're going to bowl Yorkers for a while. We're going to go bowl some short stuff. This is that sort of bowling line of length stuff is what's been happening for the last 2 hours. If Brad hadn't done like that, you're there to bat. We'll get the ball, thanks.
That happened, and it was James Pattinson. The last test match, he dropped at the batsman's feet. It was one of the younger ones, and he was just about to pick it up, and you can tell right into him, leave it there. scruffy ball now. New one in 10 overs after this, available. Not talked today, really not talked about reverse swing. Not happened. No. 70 overs then, 250 for four. Let's have a look at the bowling figures. It's hard work now for Australia. England were 18 for 1, 26 for 2, 28 for 3, 4 for 127. They're the figures. Outstanding bowler, Ryan Harris. Don't think Agar's fit. He's got a problem with the leg muscle. Shane Watson, 9 overs, 3 maidens, 1 for 30. Always looks reluctant to me. You've got to crank him up. I always think he needs oiling before he starts. Get some WD-40 into him.
Wow, wonderful movie, The Wizards of Oz, The Tin Man. He needs a bit of oiling. The one thing he'll do, Shane Watson, is bowl at the stumps. Oh, we saw last overs looking very old. The old hacked up, not much seam. And as you said, Bumble, no reverse whatsoever. There's been no real sign of it. Australia don't do it that well.
We got one of Ricky Ponting's fields here. Just look very closely where these fielders are. There's a short mid-wicket. It's fine there, the fella in here. Now, there's one going in here somewhere. Look at that. There's a non-striking batter and a fielder stood straight in front of him.
About the captaincy and the tactics in these sorts of fields, I just wonder occasionally when you do, the teams do decide to bowl at the stumps and try and get someone out LBW, that they're very reluctant to get five men on the onside. I think sometimes you can go with just, you know, three men in the ring and a slip and then have five on the on with a couple of catches there. If they get it past the catches, if you're really going to go for it, then why not, rather than just say have one or two men in the onside and it gets through the gap, attack the stumps. Shane Watson's going to be going for bold or LBW. Get the extra man on the onside.
Tell you what he did in that last game, Michael Clark, on a pitch that I mentioned, that you've got to be so careful on the drive. You couldn't hit through the ball. You've got to get the ball right under your feet. He had three short extra covers, three of them, almost all in hands, and just pushed it outside. Had that little spell, going to bowl full outside, hoping that one stops and you drive into that offside. He had three in there. Change of personnel at that silly mid-on position.
I think that's exactly what you're saying now. This is what he's trying now. They need something now just before this new ball. It's not they don't need the same stuff to happen, just back of a length, toil away, because it's got to a stage now where they've put on 123, both Bell and Bairstow. They've played well. Bell's on 93. The 28 for 3 England were. They've been able to put on 222 for only one wicket. So they need to try something different, and I think that's what Michael Clark's saying. He probably could have done it a couple of overs ago, just try something different. But she knows he's got confidence in Shane Watson's accuracy. He knows what he's going to get, so he can set these type of fields to his bowling. There's definitely a time where you go through a game where you just need to be patient and bowl your line and length stuff, and top of off and all that. But there are other times where you need to use your imagination. You just need to use it, whether you go, we're going to go short, we're going to go Yorkers, we're going to go wide and full. Just change the tactics of 15 or 20 minutes to get some rhythm back into the game. It's really important that it's an underestimated bowl, that different way to skin cats.
To maiden, 250 for four. Well, just thinking back to that last test match again. Ashton Agar gets to 98, and England, just in that field, when he's going through the 90s, they absolutely short ball. Bouncers, short leg, square leg, deep square, deep fine leg, and he gets out on the hook. And it was nothing other than bounces and chest balls. You get these little spells in a game where you can say, OK, we'll have 20 minutes of this.
And that's what I'm saying, Bubba. I agree. That's exactly what the game's calling out for now. Whatever the tactic is, whether it's short stuff, whether it's full and wide, whether it's Yorkers, slower balls, cross the seam, just something a bit different. Looks like Michael Clark's going for it now.
Well, you look at this field now, this has got Clark stamped all over it. He's got a slip. There's a slip in there, which is quite wide, about third slip. And then there's that short mid-wicket that we talk about. And then there's a short extra cover. And then there's another fielder going in a catching position square. That's Clark. Options, variations, Steve Smith was a likely lad bowling leg spin. We don't see him now.
Yeah, I think his bowling's really taken a bit of a back seat. You know, Darren Lehman, a lot of people believe that Steve Smith's the most improved cricketer batsman in Australia. And I think you saw that in the first test match. He played extremely well. And he's put more time into his batting and less time into his bowling. So he's now a bit of a last resorter. It's actually not a bad time now to give him an over or two just to see what happens. Just throwing the ball, set a pretty defensive type field. There's a time where he dabbled in off spin as well. But when you bowl leg spin and you're a bit of a part timer, it's worth just bowling a few overs. But I like the last 10 minutes or so, Michael Clark, I think, has shown a little bit more imagination than what he had done for the previous little bit of time. Just searching for a wicket before this new ball.
Well, I hope the lad's not binned his leg spin because I'm talking to the master. It's a difficult art, it really is. We've got lots of young leg spinners and they're suffering in England at the minute. No. Did you ever dabble at all? Bit of off spin?
Nothing better than dabbling a little bit, Mumble. Off spin occasionally too. Good fun dabbling. What did you like to dabble in, Bumble?
Dabbled? Where have I dabbled? I can't remember having a bit of a dabble. So long ago. Up the allotment, maybe. Well, there's a plan. Bowling a full length, but watch out for the odd short ball because there is a deep, fine leg, 15 metres in from the boundary. There's a deep mid-wicket, 15 metres in from the boundary. Might be a short ball just before drinks.
I'm just watching Michael Clark at slip there. You see that we know we've got some men back on the hook, and I just wonder if he's setting him up here for a slower ball. He's moved everyone, he's got a mid-ons come up, but he's pushed mid-off back. I just wonder if he's going to bowl a slower ball.
Well, rock solid in defence. It is a maiden, 250 for four. Hot work and thirsty work, it's drinks.
I had to make a lot of tough decisions to earn Ashes victories. Shying away wasn't an option.
Well, it's day one of the second Investec Test match. Started with the Queen meeting both teams. And of course, history being made. First time ever for having camera in the long room. Didn't help Alistair Cook. Didn't help Joe Root either. Both of them were dispatched quite quickly. And then Peterson, the third wicket going down with just 28 runs on the board. They needed a recovery, England. Jonathan Trott led it. And then he too was dismissed. 58 for Trott. And since then, Bell and Bairstow have been at it. Got a reprieve though, Johnny Bairstow. That was when the stumps were hit. But have a look at this. Nothing behind the line, so he's still there. He now has moved on to 62, Johnny Bairstow. Ian Bell is on 93, and the partnership 123. Watson is back. He has been very economical. But since the wicket of Alistair Cook, hasn't really looked threatening. They haven't been able to score. 10 overs, 1 for 30. But the pitch certainly has flattened out. Partnership of 99 between Ian Bell and Jonathan Trott. Now Bell and Bairstow, 123. Just one slip and a gully. Found the gap. Not as well timed, I don't think, to go all the way. Gets pretty close though.
Feels a wee bit different than the one we saw here earlier in the year against New Zealand, where it was still very lush. This is a lot quicker now. Good chase, very good chase by Steve Smith, right to the edge of the field there.
Feelers in close on the onside for both Bairstow and the Bell. Short mid on and a short mid wicket. None of them quite in the silly position, they're not close enough for that. And also a mid on, a wideish mid on in the gap between them both. Bairstow somewhere outside his crease there. He was on 21 when he was bowled, Johnny Bairstow. Bowled with a no ball, of course. Added 41 more runs since. That's an indication of how slow the pitch is, and also Shane Watson's lack of pace. Just another 7 overs to go after this before the new ball is due, and one suspects that Michael Clark will take it immediately. This older ball is offering nothing.
Yeah, I'd agree with that. There's no real reverse swing. There's nothing out of the ordinary. It's got tired, that ball. It's well worn, no doubt. It's soft and offering very little at all to the bowlers. Two for three for four. I suppose the only little thing is you might just delay by two or three overs, just to give whoever he gives that new ball to, which is likely to be Harris for sure, probably not Pattinson, anyone bar James Patterson on his bowling today, so Siddle, but just give them three or four each.
Pattinson has been a bit expensive. Just 16 overs for him so far, 71 runs.
Yeah, he had that one over that went for, what, 16, wasn't it? Had a one-over spell as a result of it. I always tend to think there's a certain learning curve for bowlers coming to Lords the first time, early in their careers. You're getting used to just the little things about the slope here, which can put you slightly off balance. So I'm told.
I think it's definitely true, though. Some bowlers just prefer bowling from one end or the other here at Lords because of the slope. Used to have a few grounds around the world where one end it was flat running into bowl and the other end you were running up a slope. What they have done at most of the cricket grounds around the world is that they have leveled the field. So although you might be running up a slight incline somewhere, it's nowhere near as bad as it used to be. There you can see the slope from right to left on your screen. Just a single. Gets him down to the other end. He moves on to 97, Ian Bell. That's Faulkner. Not available to bowl, though, for Michael Clarke. He's on for Ashton Agar.
Well, we thought Agar was struggling early, didn't we? Long time ago in the day. Wasn't moving so well. Not sure what the exact injury is or might be.
Runs. I think that might be four of them.
It certainly is, and you look at it again, you think it's quite a clever shot, to be honest, because he's just turned the face a wee bit to get it through the gap there. So away from the bowler, away past the umpire, well away from that short mid on.
Well, he had a look at his square leg umpire, Mardama Sena, and he gave him the signal. It's a wide, too high.
Look at that shot again that brought the four before. Talked about Johnny Bairstow and his habit of playing onside, where if it's full and straight, it's cost him his wicket a few times. When it works like this, you say fine. You say it's a good shot, and it is. It's a really nicely timed shot. .259 for four. All sorts of people here today. John Inverarity, heads the selection committee at the moment. Rod Marsh, Bacchus as he was known. Not the god of wine, but there's a place called Bacchus Marsh in Australia, a little town in the middle of nowhere, apparently. Really good man, though. Very different characters, both from West Australia. Invers was John Inverarity's headmaster, I think, wasn't he? Academic. Not sure if anyone's accused Rodney of being an academic yet, but he's a very, very good man, I can tell you that. He was a very good keeper too.
Square leg is a bit square. Gets two. On to 9-9, Ian Bell. Got 109 in the second innings at Trent Bridge, of course, Ian Bell. Well bowled, but also well played. Almost 5 hours at the crease now, Ian Bell.
Very well dug out, and just a thought for a second of sneaking the one to get to 100, but there is that silly mid on, that very straight silly mid on. He would have won any race there.
Showed you his average on this ground earlier on, Ian Bell. Before this innings, he was averaging 58 at Lords. This would have pushed it up a fraction further. That's it. Three figures again for Ian Bell, coming back for the second as well.
Well, he's now got hundreds in three successive Ashes Test matches, back-to-back hundreds here, Trent Bridge and Lords, and this has been a very fine effort to get England out of trouble. And they were 28 for three. Things were not looking good this morning, but Ian Bell has played another very, very fine innings here. Very warmly received here by a crowd that numbers just short of 29,000. All on their feet. 101 not out and 203 balls, 14 fours, 300 minutes exactly at the crease.
That's gone fine. Fine leg is very square, so that's another boundary.
Is what he needs to do to get the 100. First of all, get it into space. Celebrate, think about the second, which is very much there. Amazing how Kevin Peterson's always there, isn't he? Middle of the balcony when there's someone about to get 100, but he's there on his feet first. Kevin Peterson, celebrate with Ian Bell and for Ian Bell.
Oh, well fielded. Johnny Beer, so just might have been a bit worried that that ball would have gone back and onto the stumps. It's 2-6-7 for four.
It was like nine pins going down there. Well, important innings, two very important innings for Ian Bell. The one at Trent Bridge got them into position where they could win the match from. Who knows about this one? But looking at the list of hundreds in test matches for England, Ian Bell now ranks alongside one of the greats of all time, Sir Leonard Hutton, who made his 1900s in 79 matches. Ian Bell has got to 19 within 90 matches. But good figures. And he's still going, of course.
trying everything now, Michael Clark, constantly changing his bowlers. It's now Peter Siddle's time to operate from the pavilion end. Should have had one in that fourth column. Should have had the wicket of Johnny Bairstow, but for overstepping. Bairstow is again on strike. What next? Says Michael Clark. It's been a long time since we took a wicket. What do we try next? Brad Haddin, very experienced, of course, standing beside him. He's at first slip. Brad Haddin is the wicket keeper. Three overs at the crease now, Johnny Bairstow. Four is six of six runs. Which is similar rate of scoring as Ian Bell. Ian Bell's strike rate is 51.2, Johnny Bairstow 49.6. If you forget about the ball scored, it's quite similar as well as far as time is concerned. Ian Bell took 5 hours to get his century. That means 20 runs every hour. Johnny Bairstow, he's just about 22 runs per hour at the crease. Maiden over from Peter Siddle. Score stays on 267 for 4.
Well, another important 100 for Ian Bell. Tricky situation when he arrived at Greece at 28-3. He'd been all Australia in the morning up until then. He's played with great calm, great control. All the usual elegance you'd expect from Ian Bell as well. Lovely batting pitch after that first hour had gone. But his timing is outstanding. That's how he gets behind it, just guiding it away behind square. Wagon wheel for Ian Bell. Very strong today in terms of his boundaries through the offside. That's where the great majority have come today.
Bumble was asking about this man. He's now into the attack, Steve Smith.
Well,
Well, the first one pitched perfectly. So has a second. That should have given him a bit of confidence, and the rev counter is way up there, is well into the red. 23-77. Into the red again, even higher, 24-30. Full toss.
Well, he'd been good till then. It's always been a leg spinner's problem. If you're not Shane Warne, the problem has been to control the ball enough not to offer something like this, a rank full toss.
He got him. Took a long time to get the ball in his hand, Steve Smith, but he has taken the wicket of Ian Bell.
Well, it's one of those things that Michael Clarke does. He'll try something just to see if it works, and you have the ridiculous followed by the sublime here. Full toss is whacked away. The next ball pitches on a perfect length with the perfect turn and takes the edge. But for Ian Bell, second successive 109 in Ashes cricket.
Yes, his team needed that. Definitely needed that knock from Ian Bell. It has again been a fantastic knock. And again, access through the long room. Just polite applause as he goes through the long room. Looks a little bit disappointed, but it was a good knock. Michael Clarke tried his hunch, and he has gotten the wicket. The last ball of his first over. No doubt he'll bowl quite a few more overs now in this innings. Well, the new batsman, Matt Prior, coming in at number 7, and a solid foundation this on which to be coming in. 271 runs on the board, and here's the wicket again. This spun.
It did spin. Dipped and spun. Nice, simple chance for Michael Clarke. It seemed to take a long time to get off the outside edge, past Haddin, and into the hands, and maybe didn't nestle entirely 100% in the hands. What an irony there. Steve Smith hasn't bowled in the entire series, didn't bowl at all at Trent Bridge. First over, first wicket. England now 271 for 5, which sounds okay. There's an old way of looking at these things, which is if you add a wicket or two to the score, you might get the real situation, potential situation. And it's not quite so good. But look at that, it's a bit of turn and bounce. It takes pretty much the shoulder of the bat. So it looks like the back of the stump.
Well, we did see on the rev counter that he was in part in some spin on the ball. He was well up into the red. All it needed was for him to pitch the ball in the right area, which he eventually did. So So 5 wickets down for England. Ian Bell was involved in 2 very good partnerships, one with Jonathan Trott that produced 99 runs, and then one with Bairstow that produced 144. That should have lifted his spirits no end. Perhaps if Ashton Agar hadn't left the field, we wouldn't have seen Stephen Smith. See a lot more of him from now on, though. England run rate is still very good, almost 3.5 runs per over. That's because so many four balls have been bowled. 37 fours in this innings so far.
Well, we're back to the real Lords, really, in the sense that the outfield now is how it should be. Short enough, dry enough to allow the ball to travel quickly across it, whereas when we were here first test the summer against New Zealand, it was a much lusher, much longer, much slower. Makes a huge difference to, well, especially the batsmen, indirectly to the bowlers too.
Peter Siddle came back into the attack, had a maiden over the previous one. Is this going to be another maiden? Oh, close. It is a maiden though. Score stays 271 for 5. Seven to one for 5. 88 runs in this session so far. Change in the commentary box. We have got Andrew Strauss and Nasser Hussain. Try not to run him out again, Nas.
Sledged by Michael Holding. Just a debate between Clark and Ryan Harris between overs there. Maybe the minds are starting to think about the new ball, which is due in 2 overs time. When do you want to take it? Do you want to take it straight away? Are you fit enough to come in for half an hour tonight? Just got to concentrate doubly hard here against Steve Smith. He'll bowl you the odd full toss, but look at the revs. The wicket ball went into the red zone. He does give it a big tweak. The wrist spinner does spin it more. Any wrist spinner will spin it more than a finger spinner. It will also bowl you the odd bad ball. Again, into the red zone.
Have a look at the wicket ball here. Watch the revs on that ball and really flicks it out of the fingers. It's a perfect ball, one that Shane Warden would be pretty proud of, really. Bit of drift, turn down the slope there. Not a lot Ian Bell could have done about it. Good captaincy by Michael Clark, bringing Smith on.
Yeah, the only debate was what Shane Warne said earlier. Could he have brought him on earlier in the day? What over was that, Benny? He's a 76th over, 77th, 77th over. But he could have brought him on a little bit earlier. Consistently going into the red zone now with spin. Just because wrist spinners tend to have that little bit more on the ball. And it will produce the drift in. And then the spin away.
And to get a man out on 109, you need a special delivery, and that was one. 7 and a bit degrees.
I suppose Steve Smith, not known for his accuracy, leg spins are hard art anyway. I suppose that's always at the back of Michael Clark's mind. You know, are you going to let the opposition off the hook? In the end, he decided a couple of overs before the new ball, and it worked for him.
It's good. Drifting.
I'm assuming that you'd be recommending taking the new ball straight away here.
It just depends on the fitness of his seamers, actually. A long, hard, hot day. Smith's landing it okay. I'd go for a couple more. Oh, I think he is landing it okay. 274 for five. Yeah, I'd probably go a couple more before you take the new ball. I thought they went to the new ball a little bit early at Trent Bridge with Matt Pryor in. Matt Pryor can hurt you against that new ball. Seamers haven't bowled that much. You'd definitely go with a new ball this evening. It's just how long for.
The thing for me is Matt Pryor on two. He's only faced three balls. I'd be quite keen to get that new ball at him straight away before he gets going. I understand your point, he could get away from you, but Matt Pryor, good player of spin. I don't think Steve Smith's going to worry him particularly. I'd be tempted to go straight away.
Well, they're going to play till 6:45, Andrew, so you got 40 minutes left. Maybe just another 10 minutes of Siddle and Smith, and then the new ball for half an hour. I'll definitely give Smith one more. He's deserved one more. So his figure's two overs, correction. Two overs, yeah, two overs, 1 for 7.
I'd take him off.
Who, Steve Smith? Two overs, 1 for 7. You're a harsh captain.
I'd take him off. I just think, get that new ball straight away. As you say, 35 odd minutes, 40 minutes till close. Get those seamers on, get the new ball at Matt Pryor.
Well, there's a few warming up, so maybe Clark's going with your way. Wonder if the coach is listening again. Would you take the new ball? Will he take the new ball? He's the man that makes the decisions.
Great to have all this input from Buff, isn't it? Just a little bit of an inside scoop.
Just a little bit of in-drift there. Not as much reverse here, obviously, with the lush outfield as there was at Trent Bridge, but just a little bit. Actually, what happens here, as you know, Andrew, the pitch gets harder day two, day three. And that ball starts scuffing up a little bit more. So what you don't see on day one might just happen day two, day three. Is that right?
Yeah, I think that's right. You did the masterclass at Trent Bridge about the ball hitting the wicket and scuffing up. There are some wicket ends, so you could throw it in there, but most of the reverse swing comes from actually hitting that pitch hard with the ball, and it's not dry enough yet.
There's that man again for Pryor. He was caught there in the first test match.
If anything, the fact that it hasn't reversed today just shows you the importance of reverse swing. At times it's looked very flat, hasn't it? And Michael Clark's had to give some quite inventive fields. Steve Smith's had a bowl. Just watching Matt Pryor's dismissals in this series so far. That was that kind of loose drive where he scores a lot of his runs. Michael Clark's got the same man in position today for that exact shot.
Good work. Whoa, a little dance as well from Ryan Harris at the end. That'll loosen him up. 274 for five. New ball is available. Clark debating. I'm sure we will have the new ball at some stage, just not now. It's going to be Steve Smith. Got a smile on his face. He's a much improved cricketer, Steve Smith. Oh no, would you believe it? Would you believe it? The drift in. The low full toss, and Smith has two.
Oh, Nasser's talking about him having another over, and he's delivered. A soft dismissal there. Like a full toss, I think. And he's just patted it back to Steve Smith. That is a freebie. Johnny Bairstow will be very frustrated about that just before the new ball as well.
Bairstow's gone for 67, it's 274 for six.
Sky Sports coverage of the Ashes is sponsored by The Times and The Sunday Times. Sky Sports coverage of the Ashes is sponsored by The Times and The Sunday Times.
Tim Bresnan comes in at number eight, and this game going like the last, really, one way then the other. Australia bossed it in the first hour, then England came back, and now in the last hour, Australia have two very quick wickets. One, an absolute beauty, and the other one, just a filthy full toss. Johnny Bairstow should have hit into the stands, and he hit it straight back to Steve Smith. Cunning plan from Clark. Don't take the new ball and bowl a low full toss. Slightly quicker delivery out the front of the hand. It's a full toss, and because he's getting revs on it, it just drifts in a little bit to Johnny Bairstow. He should have just whacked it. He just clips it straight back to the bowler. That'll be four. Bresnan off the mark.
Yeah, Tim Bresnan off and running there. Got to give Clark credit for this. One's just a little bit short there from Steve Smith, but a lot of credit goes to Michael Clark. Steve Smith, come on, have a few overs, get me a wicket, and he's delivered. He's done exactly what his captain's asked him to do.
take the new ball with Bresnan in.
Good boy, Smith.
Absolutely. Might seem a bit harsh on Smith. Have a go now for half an hour at England.
Well, two new batsmen on strike as well. I mean, it's perfect. Set up perfectly for six or seven overs, that new ball. Really hit England hard. 278 for six.
Bairstow could not believe what he had done. All the hard work. Got that slice of luck and he wanted to make him pay. That will ruin your rehydrate at the end of the day.
Those dismissals hurt you much more than get a good ball or nick off. I feel like that's your fault. The bowler's done nothing there. You've been completely at fault and they hurt. They linger all night long. Kicking the walls in his hotel room tonight.
Still the old ball.
Ian Bell played well for 109. Johnny Bairstow, really good support. A good stand there from England. Two new men at the crease now. Matt Prior on two, Tim Bresnan on five. Really important period of play here just before the close. Andy Flower looking a little frustrated there. It's been another seesawing day here. As we can see, England 28 for three at one point before. 99 run partnership between Trott and Bell and the big partnership between Bell and Bairstow. Both of them fell in quick succession and now England find themselves under pressure again right at the back end of the day. England should benefit from Bresnan's capabilities with the bat in this test match. Never pick him for his batting ability, but it certainly helps. Another guy that can use up time, can certainly get a 50. He's shown that many times in his career. They're averaging 31.64 with three test 50s. Good guy to have coming in at number eight.
Yeah, and the warm-up game at Chelmsford against Essex got 100, although it wasn't a first-class game in the end. He's in decent nick, but it's completely different. Wide of the crease, angling in. There's not much movement away now. Most of the movement's in.
Is Steve Smith going to get one more over, I wonder, Matt?
A maiden, 279 for six. If you are just coming in from work, missed a day that's gone one way, then the other. Alistair Cook, LBW, Watson's one over, just brought on by the skipper, gut feeling. and it paid off. LBW. Joe Root, full delivery that came back in, reviewed it, was given out. Peterson went the other way. Another full delivery that moved away. Trott just poked one up in the air, two men out. Khawaja took the catch. And then a beauty to Bell, who played brilliantly for 109. And then a full toss that was just chipped back to the bowler. Smith has two, and he's still on. Four maidens for Siddle from the pavilion end. Steve Smith trying to get an extra one, another one at the nursery end. He likes bowling at this ground. He has six test wickets, five of them at this ground. He got three for against Pakistan. Oh, that's a beauty. A really good delivery, that one.
He's bowled well, Steve Smith, hasn't he? Getting a real rip here, but that's drifted, turned not beautifully. Showing that there is turn in this wicket, even on day one, there's a bit of turn there, and he's made full use of that, Steve Smith.
Oh! Good smash!
His shot back up, and Watson wants that ball to go for four. It does.
So little margin for error, short of a length. As a spinner against Matt Pry, using his feet so quickly, gets well back in the crease, cut that off just outside off stump. I mean, you'd say it's a risky shot right off the toe of the bat, but he plays it so consistently, Matt Pry.
So he's back again, Matt Pry. Another good over from Steve Smith, 283 for six. Big debate from Michael Clark and his seamers about the new ball. Should they, shouldn't they? Two great cricket brains up here. Siri and both of Michael Atherton.
What does he want? He must want something.
He wants something, or he needs something, or he's done something.
Well, it's been a good day's play. Swung this way and that. Australia had the best of the earlier parts of it. England came back. Late wickets to Stephen Smith. Well-balanced day, 283 for six. I reckon first innings run is going to be important. It looks a dry pitch. Just see the dark circles where the bowlers have followed through, which are quite prominent. For a first day pitch here at Lord's, suggests it's dry and will help the spinners later. Moments of intuition from Michael Clark today. Early on, when he brought Shane Watson into the attack in the fifth over, paid immediate dividend, and then when he threw the ball to Stephen Smith as well. Immediate dividend there.
Defense, I think we've been asking a little while, and why wouldn't give Smith a one or two overs just to see what happens? Anyway. Chose not to at Trent Bridge. Have here to say the delivery he got Ian Bell with was a very good delivery.
Yeah, I spoke to one or two people who watched Australia's warm-up at Taunton. They said he, maybe it was Worcester, whichever one of the two warm-up games it was, he bowled fairly ordinary stuff, I think. Ed Cowan, who was at short leg, was under heavy bombardment. But he's that type of bowler, isn't he? He's going to bowl a bit of filth and then the odd good ball.
There's some interesting signs, isn't there? They're already showing a little bit of turn. We saw this, the top disturbed on a couple of occasions.
It's just talking Moraes through it. Dip and drift did for Johnny Bairstow. Chatting about the new ball.
Pretty sure that's what it'll be about, yeah.
It's drifting down. It's a little reverse swing, but only a hint, really. 283 for six. Remember that play started at 11:15 today because of the visit of the Queen, so we go on to 6:45. Six overs remaining. Do you ever have to introduce the team to the Queen here, Beefy? 1981?
Yeah, probably. Centenary test match, yeah.
Good.
Have to give her three cheers in the committee room. That's the captain's duty, isn't it? It's a bit embarrassing, but you're kind of told you've got to do it.
I don't mind that. I like a little bit of tradition and pomp and ceremony. Why not? It's good. Let's not lose our identity totally.
Oh, nice,
Mac. I think what she does for this country is amazing. Work schedule, 87 years old.
38 for three, she departed today. I think she'd seen enough. Yeah! That's a beautiful ball from Smith. He's got another. He's out of the front of the hand and flatter, a bit of a flipper, really. And Matt Prior looking to cut the ball away as edge through to Haddin.
The game is moving on. Well, if there was any discussion about taking the new ball, it's probably not going to happen now. Oh, it's a good catch as well, so it's quite a thick edge. Steve Smith picks up three. He's now got 3 for 16. Matt Prior's the latest one to go. He's gone for six. It's 283 for seven.
In his last test, I knew Freddie had one more moment of magic left in him.
The night watchman, Jimmy Anderson. I'm not sure he can quite believe it. I'm not sure Shane Watson can either, but he's there to protect Stuart Broad. Maybe from a gobful, he might have got a little bit had he come out at this stage. And Graham Swan as well. It's definitely out of the front of the hand. It's a good ball. Pryor thinks it's shorter, but because it's out of the front of the hand and a bit flatter, it's not as short as Pryor thinks. It's a good catch too. Yep, Darren Lehman likes it. Clark's intuition has proved to be very profound. 3 for 16 now for Stephen Smith. Not sure Jimmy's in the greatest nick, actually. I've been watching him in the nets. He's been tinkering with his technique. He's got this open kind of chested two-eyed technique, but just every time I watch him in the nets, he just gets his poles rolled over.
Well, I beg to ask the question, what's he doing out there anyway?
All ducks in his last 6 test innings, says Benedict, which is a confirmation. They did well to delay the new ball. I'm sure Clark and Watson were talking about that. Shall we take it? Shall we take it? Now let's give Stephen Smith one more vital wicket of Matt Pryor. And now they've got that new ball up their sleeve. Pryor's gone. They can take it whenever. Tomorrow morning. See, he's constantly in that red zone, is Stephen Smith. He gets plenty on the ball. So, a few bad deliveries mixed in. If Australia can get on top and get a lead. Good man to have up your sleeve on a wearing pitch. He's getting some spin already. 283 for 7, 5 overs remaining. So the game has turned around. What were England? They were 271 for 4, 38, 28 for 3, then 271 for 4, and now 283 for 7. So Australia starting and have ended the day well. The middle period belonged to England.
Well, I reckon it's Australia's day. 283 for 7 on this surface, I think, is Australia's day. And those... Oh, look at it. It's weird, isn't it? 28 for 3. And then England then dominate, 127 for 4, they get a 99-run partnership, then you get the big partnership, and then it goes bang, bang, bang. So I give it to Australia at the moment.
Clark just moving those fielders a bit straighter, a bit closer. Those two men catching on the leg side.
Oh!
You just feel that Bresnan just pushes the ball in the air, very straight. Looks much happier now, doesn't he, than at 271 for 4. There's that reverse swing from Ryan Harris.
Bowls it well, doesn't he, up there? Sit up there, tacks the stumps.
It's got a kind of action you'd think he would reverse the ball. Slightly low arm, slingy action, hasn't he?
Almost got through.
groping at thin air, Anderson. Sure he's got much confidence in his batting right now. Much about that, didn't Jimmy? He came off the glove. He gets his first run, 285 for seven.
That's well directed. More encouragement, isn't there, in this pitch for the wicket bowlers? Didn't know very much about that at all. Not an any idea at all where it had gone. Quite sure, I still can't get my head around why he's out there.
Four overs remaining. Stephen Smith maybe just eyeing up a little five for. He's got three for 16 off five. He's got a chance to bowl at Jimmy Anderson now. Michael Clark posts a couple of more attacking fielders. Slip gully, short leg. Has taken one on the hands, so he's taking a moment out to make sure he's okay. I get the four overs in. We got 8 minutes remaining.
Full toss was the bonus. The other two wickets were good balls. Bells turned and bounced, and that prior was just the length, not the front of the hand. Gets away with that one.
Smith, that's the hard spun leg break. The one that got prior was a different delivery. It's out of the front of the hand. This is the last ball, so the seam there in a good position going down towards what, second slip or so. The variation that we've seen was the prior dismissal, which we'll show you in a minute. It's good delivery. Delivery Shane Warne bowled a lot, just kind of push it out of the front of the hand. It's not the genuine flipper, but a bit of a backspin, a pushed out of the front of the hand. Yeah, you can see the ball just rotating backwards. When Shane Warne lost his ability to bowl what you'd call a genuine flipper, that's the ball he bowled more and more out of the front of the hand.
Didn't it put so much stress on his shoulder, I think, didn't it? Bowling it the orthodox way.
That's right. All thin air for Jimmy. Again, pushed out of the front of the hand. 287 for seven. Let's have a look at the difference out of the hand. This is Ian Bell on the left, I think. And that's the orthodox leg break. With the overspin on the ball, side spin and overspin, and then the prior delivery pushed out of the front of the hand with more backspin on the ball.
And I think the thing with that one at the front of the hand, I think it's harder to pick the length. And I think, as is the flipper, when you do all the orthodox flipper.
Absolutely, and that's what did for Pryor. He thought it was short because he saw it flatter. Went for the cut. Anyway, that's all in the past now because Australia decided to take the new ball. So we'll either get one more over, possibly two. Ryan Harris has it.
Hustle and bustle, isn't he? Ryan Harris comes in. It's a powerful looking man, strong man.
Bit of Darren Goff there.
Oh, he moves a lot better than Goffey.
Who's better than Goffey now? In his pump, though.
No, I agree. You know, he's got Goffey covered at the moment.
Had him moving well there as well, down the leg side. Good effort, that. Long, hot day in the field. Keep your standards high right till the end. Well, it's really slingy low arm. The ball swung early from the arm. Sot Bresnan going after it, though.
It started wide and went wider. There you go, look. Way out there, it's gone after it.
Who's the happier side, Beefy? Australia?
I would think so, yeah, because they've got everything's happened just at the right time of the day. Towards the end of the day, four down, suddenly seven down. I reckon that man there will be pretty happy. I'm not so sure the other balcony will be feeling quite as good. 270-odd for four. And an unlikely hero, isn't it, Steve Smith?
Absolutely. Mind you, you've got to remember England were 38 for three as well. So from that position, it's not been a disastrous day, but I agree with you.
28 for three. Even worse.
Yeah, absolutely.
I suppose you'd say that England would say, well, from 28 for three to get to where we are, approaching 300, still with 3 weeks left, good day. But I think the way they started the day, Australia, those quick wickets, they're nothing or very little. And when they were down, then on comes Steve Smith and... three quick wickets.
So Bresnan survives Harris's last over of the day, 287 for seven. You reckon there'll be another over? So there will be one more. We're going to miss out on one over. 89 will be bowled by the time that clock ticks around past quarter two. James Pattinson will complete the day. He's not had a good day, really. 17 overs for 77. I've seen a lot of young seamers come here and struggle with the ends and the slope and just not sure which is the best end to bowl. Can't quite get the line right. He's just had one of those days where he's been short of rhythm.
I think Harris is at the right end for him. I think the pavilion end is for him. He's at the stumps. He's Pattinson, would have thought, would have suited this end. He tries to go away with the new ball.
He just had an unfortunate start, didn't he? Bowling to Cook, had a left-hander on strike and got milked a bit leg side, and that's why Clark took him off straight away. He only bowled two overs and brought Watson into the attack. So he started the day at the nursery end. He's going to finish it there to a left-hander as well. Now, short leg in, leg gully. Anderson is going to get a mixture here of short balls from Patterson to keep him pushed back, and also that full ball that might just swing in.
I think initially they'll be shorter than fuller.
Shadows of the floodlights just creeping in past the slip fielders. Full ball, and it did swing in a touch, but straight onto the middle of Anderson's bat.
Doing his job, Jimmy. They're all chasing it hard. The Aussies didn't realise that they've just wandered down. Gentle stroll for two. I will stay protecting. Doing my job, night watchman. Digs us out. Nothing more than a defensive push. Easily have had three, but took the responsibility.
Benedict's just reminded us of the test match in Perth. Do you remember when Anderson was being night watchman and gave Collingwood the strike for the last over of the day, and he got out to the last what became the last ball of the day. This time he's stayed on strike. One more ball and then Stuart Broad can take off all the protective gear. Final ball of the day. Anderson survives. So England end the day 289 for 7. 89 overs bowled, so we'll miss out on one. Michael Clarke applauding his men. They've had a pretty good day, Australia. They got three early wickets. They picked up three late ones as well through to that man, Stephen Smith, who gets a hug from Ashton Agar. Smith that took the wickets today, not Agar. Three cheap ones right at the end of the day. So from 271 for 4, England 289 for 7 at the end of the day. Anderson, the night watchman, accompanies Bresnan off the field. Lots of people have left, not quite as busy as it was earlier on in the day, but still plenty of members in the long room to applaud Anderson and Bresnan back. They make their way up the steps now into the England dressing room. The Australians will head the other way. Long, hot day, but a good one for them. He's going to go in first. Ryan Harris and then Stephen Smith, both together. They will head the other way. They'll turn right. Stairs into the visitors' dressing room. This way to end the day. a beautiful day here at Lord's. England won the toss, decided to bat. We've had 89 overs and England got to 289 for 7 by the end. There was a 1900 for Ian Bell, 67 for Johnny Bairstow, and a half century for Jonathan Trott as well.
Bowling, Pattinson, not as good as he would have wanted to be today. A little bit off colour, none for 79. Watson picked up an early wicket, one for 41. Siddle, none for 53. Agar, none for 44. Harris and Smith, the heroes. 3 for 43 for Harris. And Smith, amazingly, 6 overs, 1 maiden, 3 for 18.
Well, the end of a longish first day here at Lord's. Time to talk to Andrew. And the obvious topic is, or the obvious question, what about Steve Smith then? A masterstroke from Michael Clarke.
It was a masterstroke. I mean, come completely out of left field, almost thrown the ball in desperation by Michael Clarke. Struggling for ideas, but he produced a beauty to get rid of Ian Bell. Really good ball, that. You know, England weren't probably expecting him to bowl, and maybe that's done them more than anything, but really good bit of captaincy from Clarke. That was an unfortunate dismissal, if ever there was one, for
Steve
Smith.
That's so kind of you, yeah.
Nice, juicy full toss, and, well, I was going to say it's easily done, but you feel bad when it does happen. And then the quicker ball to get rid of Matt Prior, that was a very good ball from Steve Smith, and he's really changed the context of this game completely. Wrestled it from England's favour into one where Australia probably just edged the day.
Well, it's been an up-and-down day again, hasn't it? Because Australia, obviously, Harris at the start was outstanding. Ian Bell then, of course, another 100, successive hundreds for Ian Bell. Played just as well, if not better, than he did at Trent Bridge.
Yeah, very fluent all day today. And when Ian Bell plays well, it looks so easy, doesn't it? Effortless shots all around the wicket, a lot of touch. And just a brilliant 100. Got in good form last week and now he's making the most of that form, which is always the challenge for a batsman, to make the most of form when you've got it. He did that really well today.
Well, it was needed. What was it, 28 for 3 when he came in after those three early wickets to Ryan Harris. This is where he's made them today. A lot of fours, a lot of boundaries through the offside today. But this time, whereas at Trent Bridge, a lot of them were behind square, very different pitch, very different conditions today, and he's been good through extra cover and cover. But if you look at the day, at the end of the day, 289 for 7, and he won the toss, and he batted first in glorious conditions like this, that's not a great day for England.
I don't think it is a great day. I mean, when they were 28 for 3, maybe they would have settled for it, but when you bat first at Lord's, especially the way this wicket played, it looked very flat at times. England would like to have at least two less wickets on the score, and Australia can feel very satisfied with their day's work.
Quick word about Johnny Bairstow, another 50 for him here. That's three in a row now he's made. South Africa last year a couple, this one here today.
Yeah, he played well, had a bit of luck early on. He got that ball that where he was given out off a no ball. That here it is here. Mm-hmm. Need to make use of that luck, and he did it pretty well. And as you can see, just a no ball there. He played some good shots. Yeah. Strong hitter of the ball. He's a good boundary hitter, Johnny Bairstow. Really, a bit of luck there. I suppose he'll be frustrated by the way he got out at the end of the day there. I mean, he'd done all the hard work, and he would have been thinking, maybe I could come back tomorrow and get 100, and wasn't meant to be.
All right, OK, let's leave it there. Running out of time. Thanks, Andrew. Just a few things to tell you about as normal at this time of day, at this stage of the day. First of all, we've got the highlights tonight at 8. They'll be on this Sky Sports Ashes channel, of course, as they will be throughout the summer, followed by The Verdict. Now, during The Verdict, there'll be interviews with Steve Smith and Ian Bell. You'll hear more from them during that verdict, and, of course, from Charles and Bob and Tom. We've got our live coverage of day two of the second Investec Test match starting yet again, 10 o'clock in the morning, and of course on the Sky Sports Ashes HD channel. And for more reaction to what's been going on here today, that's Sky Sports News at 7. We'll have all the up-to-date news about today's play here at Lord's. But a glorious day here today. We're hoping for great weather again tomorrow and great cricket. Let's hope you can join us then. For now, it's goodbye.